I'm Chris Stafford, and this is Season 1, Episode 7 of Art, the podcast about female artists. If you don't feel it, I'll make you feel it. I'll show you what I mean. If you don't feel it, I'll make you feel it. I'll bring you to your knees if you follow me. Hello, and thank you if you're just joining me for the first time here on the Art Podcast. This is where we get up close and personal with female artists from around the world and across all mediums to get to know the person behind their art. And you can join in the conversation by following us on social media. We're on Instagram at the Art Podcast. That's art with two A's. I'd love to hear from you and about the female artist whose work you admire and who you think should be on the show. My guest this week was introduced to me by Chrissy Blumenthal in LA. Claudia Concha describes herself as a gestural expressionist, painting with both hands at the same time, sometimes just with sticks, and mostly with her eyes closed. Claudia was born and raised in Bogatá, Colombia, and moved with her husband to Santa Monica in 2003, where they live with their two children. Her studio is every artist's dream, in an aircraft hangar at Santa Monica Airport, where she also holds her exhibitions. While she was not artistic as a child, she was always creative. Subsequently, her college education in architecture and studies in Italy clearly influence her work on a large scale. Her paintings can occupy an entire wall to accommodate the physical effort they demand. Her art is self-described as a conversation connecting with every part of her body using the Gestalt method and healing techniques. For Claudia, her art has a deep spiritual emphasis, which she also conveys in her workshops and art therapy. Claudia, hello, and thank you for joining me. Welcome to the first season. Have you had a chance to listen to any yet?
I heard a little bit of some of them.
I'm glad to have discovered you through a mutual friend in LA, and she was telling me about your art. And of course, I went to look for you on Instagram and on your website. And it's a fascinating story. We have had a chat a week or so ago, wasn't it, that we had a chat and
yes.
To get to know each other. And you're from Bogota in Colombia, but you've lived in LA for a number of years now, married with two children. And really very much established in your art and life, really, in LA, but developed a very unique style too, Claudia. So let's start at the beginning and, you know, where your influences came from when you were growing up in Colombia.
Oh, thank you. And thank you for having me in this podcast. I'm so grateful. So my story started, it's interesting because when I grew up, my parents were not in the art. My dad is a lawyer. My mom is a communicator. But then I had an uncle and an aunt. He's an architect. She's an artist. And I think they influenced me a lot because I really like their worlds. And since then I grew up, I was always very creative, very visual. I liked to play. And I think that was part of my creativity, even though I was not showing signs of art in the moment or painting, because I was in a very academic school. But it was interesting, the things that called me, like I love art history. I was very into it, and math and mathematics, interesting enough, algebra. And I see how all that has the creative aspect. And the playing, since very little, I would play by myself. I was very creative in the way I played. So I think that really influenced my life. And then our history, you know, since I started learning all the Michelangelo, I remember since seeing the Sistine Chapel through my art history classes, I was very drawn by art and architecture. Interesting. I was always looking, and nature was another part of my life. I would play a lot, like Colombia has a lot of green. And we're surrounded by so much nature. And during the weekends, we would travel. And always I was playing outside and I was always looking the light. And I remember that I would love or be sometimes being in a pool, looking how the light would get into the trees. I was very sensitive to that, even how the light came in the windows. I really enjoy that. So I think all that is part of how I develop my path.
So when you were a child, what mediums were you using then for your creativity?
Yes. So the mediums were, well, we use a lot of watercolors, clay. I remember playing a lot with clay, and with watercolors, with crayons, whatever was there available. Not much, sometimes acrylics, but it was more the watercolor.
So you had art history at school then. And what about college? Did you study art as a form in college?
Yes. So I studied architecture first. When I was deciding before, like in my school, I was all about, you know, art history. And we had some art classes that I enjoy a lot. And then I decided to study architecture. So I went and I have my bachelor's degree as an architect in Bogota, in the University of Los Andes. After that, I moved to, so when I graduated, I went to Florence. And that's where I started. I studied art and art history for a year. It was fascinating. That's where my painting, like my art started. Even though I did it before in the architecture, I was drawing all the time. I love to draw cities. I was very in the free form drawing. I enjoy it a lot. Then in Italy, I learned technique, like oils, painting with models. I was in the Scuola Lorenzo dei Medici. It was such an amazing year. And that's where my career moved more towards art, even though I was doing parallel. After I came back from Italy, I joined a workshop with an artist, Rita Miranda. And it was a weekly workshop of 8 hours with women of different ages. And all the purpose was really getting into how I paint now. That's my biggest influence. And it was on learning everything I knew as an artist and as an architect to find my own language. So I painted 8 years black and white. It was painting with the eyes closed, non-dominant hands, using a lot of automatic painting. We were talking a lot of art history as well. And I connected a lot with abstract expressionism. And I found working on paper and ink, that was like the water medium for a reason. It really called to me. And I love water. So I think it has a lot to do with it. And I started finding my own language. And my teacher even didn't let me show my work. It was very an introspective work. So from that work, I started really, I always like as well, my sister is a psychologist and I like psychology. I knew about Carl Jung with someone I really was drawn to, and Freud. And I even did psychoanalysis at the same time I was doing these workshops. We talk about that with my teacher. She was the one that told me, do it, because it's a special moment. And to work both at the same time. And I started understanding how all about subconscious, unconscious, how my psyche, like, and how my life was very involved in my art. And that was fascinating. So as I share all those 8 years, just black and white were very important. The purpose of it was not getting distracted by color. So the forms and what was coming from within had the power and were not influenced by design or how to do pretty things. I learned about myself a lot and how to not please people. It was finding my voice as an artist, and it transformed my entire life, my approach to architecture, my approach to life.
I'm sure there are people listening, Claudia, who would wonder how you got that ideal opportunity as a young woman to go to Italy to study art. So how did that opportunity come about?
Well, it was right after. I always had this before that, when I was in architecture school, I did a study abroad in Scotland, in Edinburgh. So that was the first time I went to Europe. And before getting into Scotland, I traveled like for a month with a friend. We went to Paris like for 3 weeks. So all the traveling put me in more in direct contact with all I study and I was fascinated about. And then when we went to Greece, Switzerland, and then in Edinburgh, it was fascinating, the architecture, the culture. So there I was still studying architecture. So I had, it was 6 months. Then when I went back to Colombia, I stayed, like, I had that, oh my God, I want to go again. And in that time when I graduated from architecture, Italy became, I started seeing France, like the places I could go. And Italy was like a call, where Michelangelo was and all the history also I study. And it has both art and architecture. And a friend was investigating as well. And we found this in Florence, the Scuola Lorenzo dei Medici. We apply, and then my parents supported all this trip. And it was like, so I went there. It was a year, and a year of studying art, history of architecture, like life. Like, we would go to the museums, we would go to the buildings, and then traveling. I went with a friend that she also graduated from architecture. And we travel a lot in Europe, backpacking, and it was such an amazing life experience.
What age would you have been then?
That was in 1995. So the first time I was 21 when I went to Scotland, and in 1994, so I was 24 when I went to Italy.
So which artists then at that time, I might imagine European artists, were influential in it with you, and whose work that you most admired? Who was it that you were really attracted to? Were there any women?
You know, that was interesting. And there were, but I was more attracted, like Leonardo da Vinci for me was like, wow, surprised me so much because he was beyond art. He was a creator, investigator. I really dig into his work. In that time, I was more drawn into them, you know, and all the impressionists as well, like Van Gogh. And interesting enough, now that I was, when you ask me about the women, I study more after the women, like the ones I told you, Elaine de Kooning and John Mitchell, Mary Abbott. It was after this process. In the beginning, I learned more, like it was interesting. The classes were more focused on male artists. And that's interesting because there were many women at the time as well. So after I studied and moved back to Colombia and started this process, is when I started learning more about the female artists like Elaine de Kooning and Joan Mitchell, Mary Abbott, Deborah Remington and Judith Godwin. And one woman that influenced me a lot in that time was Olga de Amaral. She's from Colombia. She worked with textile. So, and I was very called to installations because I mix, like, architecture is my passion and art as well. So I love space and I love the mix of both. And Olga de Amaral, she works with textiles and installations. And her technique incorporates fiber, gesso, metals. And she transforms the textiles into structures, like sculptures. She uses gold as a main color, which it has a lot of connection to Colombia. And she's connected to the native Colombian Indians, which I am as well, the indigenous. And that's all the story in our mountains. When the Spanish came to conquer, these indigenous, were the Taironas in the coast, in the Atlantic coast. They had a lot of gold, and the Spanish wanted that gold, and they were taking it. So there is a lot of story around gold and the wisdom that the gold brings to the indigenous. So Olga de Amaral worked with that. And so she was mixing our culture and the textiles and the installations. She influenced me a lot. Like, I remember seeing her work. I was just drawn by it. She was very important to me at that time.
And have you been able to have conversations with these women you admire?
No, I never met her directly. No, I always went to the exhibitions. I've heard about them talking, but I never met them in person.
Now, your journey from there has been fascinating, Claudia. How you've merged, your art into a conversation and how you express yourself. Just give us the background as to how that came about and how you developed that style of gestural expressionism.
Yes. Okay. So after I did all this, I was working in Colombia. So after I came back from Florence, as I mentioned, I worked like for 8 years with Rita Miranda in this way of painting. Then I got married to my husband, Jose. He's a dentist. He was born in Florida, but he grew up in Colombia. We met, we were dating, then we got married, and we were dating through my process. He saw a lot of my process those three last years. He got involved and very interested, even though his agendas were very different, but he was very attracted by it. And in that time, I also founded a furniture design company in Colombia. So it was an interesting place where I merged architecture through furniture and art. And I was also starting to try to show my work very little. Then we decided he always wanted to have, his dream was to move to the US and have an experience. And he got his license for California. That was the place he could, do present the exams and tests. So he got his license as a dentist. And we decided, I always like an adventure, as I mentioned before, in living outside and learning about living and having experiences with other cultures. So we decided to move to California. And it was like, where do we move? Like really with a finger, LA, because of weather. We were thinking about being long time, and I like tropical. The weather is important for me, and it's the biggest city. So we just finger, like we said, we were thinking San Francisco or Los Angeles. So we moved to LA, but it was like an adventure, having nothing. He had two friends, dentist friends here, and we connected to them, and we just sold everything. Our family supported us. His family and my family stay in Colombia, and we just moved here. And a month after he found a job, and I got pregnant, so our life changed. And making the story short, in 2012, we moved in 2003, and I continued to paint. So I focused on painting. I worked a little bit on my furniture still. And then I started focusing on painting. And in my house, my daughter was born. Then I had my son. Always where we lived in my garage, I had my art studio. And I was working, I was working, I was showing friends and the people I started to get to know. And in 2012, 2000, yeah, 11, I joined this master's on spiritual psychology. Because I always knew, and the colors, this is another part of the story. I was painting black and white only. When I moved here is where I was starting to add colors. And I started working just with one color at the time, really. So the color I knew had purpose. And I continued to evolve my art more, adding now the color. Then I joined this master's in spiritual psychology, which was so, inspiring because it has all the psychology and the spirituality that was so important for me since I grew up. I was always very spiritual as a child. My family was not religious. I had it in me. It was, I always investigated since a child. I was very interested about India, Buddhism, many, many cultures. So the master was helpful because another aspect of my art on those 8 years, I knew a lot of information was coming. I was painting and I knew information was in my paintings, but I couldn't access that. In that time, there was another painter that was sometimes seeing my art and he would talk about me just by seeing it. And I was intrigued by how he could see that. He was very accurate. So I always knew that. And then the master's in spiritual psychology helped me a lot, like moving to a new level, my art, because through a technique named Gestalt, I learned about it in that how you can create conversation with your body, with your life, with your memories, with your dreams. So that merged into my art. I was like, this is how I can access the information I knew was there. So I created, as a graduating project, this conversations with my body. And it was a project. And then I started seeing how my, well, my art has been very gestural. And so conversations with my body was a project where I gave a voice to each part of my body. And that was interesting because before this, I would work and just an intention of being present in whatever emotion, whatever was present, I would give a voice to it with the eyes closed and on dominant hand. Now I brought more an intention of, okay, I'm giving a voice to my feet, to my knees, to the right knee, to the left knee, my legs. It was a very fascinating experience. I created, it was like 13 pieces. And the best part of it, I was so excited when I was doing it. And I was thinking, oh, I'm creating my masterpieces. And what happened was the opposite. I didn't like them. And it was a shock. I was, what happened? And then I remember my teacher, Rita Miranda, who always said, if you don't like a piece, like really hate it, don't throw it away because it may have information you don't want to access, maybe. So I kept that in mind and I was like, whoa. And when I started working, so first I painted them. And then the second aspect of it was doing a gestalt. So trying to access the information. And in the beginning it was a little hard because I was not like liking the pieces. And all of a sudden one day I was looking at one, 5 minutes, and just a lot of symbols that were like stories show up. I started seeing things and figures, and it connected me to memories. And it was profound. One of them was with my dog. The other one was with my horses. I used to horseback ride, and how when I stopped horseback riding, what the impact it had in me. It became like a healing of memories process. It was fascinating. And I will record it as much as possible. That I wrote it about it. And I created this book named Gestural Art, where all this process is. And in that moment, I realized how I could share this with others, because it was very healing and very an awakening for me. And that's where, So that's where my workshops started. So I started doing, after that, I started practicing workshops, sharing this work. Yes.
So tell us what size and what format you were painting in, because I'm on your website, these are all very large pieces, aren't they? And
yes.
I'm wondering if that was always the case, or you just grew bigger as your art evolved. And what about the medium?
Yeah, so that was the case. So since I started the workshops, even in Italy, they were pretty good size. When I was painting oils and people, right? We had models. All were already minimum of 36 by 48 canvases. So, and I like big because I like movement. When I paint, I always incorporated my entire body, not just the separation of the hand and sitting. For me, that was hard. I was always involved, big gestures. That's why impressionists, I like them a lot, like all those strokes. So that's why I needed usually big formats. So in Italy, I was working oil and canvas. Then in Colombia, I was working with a lot of paper and ink. So those 8 years, I worked a lot of paper and ink on paper. And they were also big and very fast. I was working very fast to not control. So the idea is doing gestures, and the ink helped because it's very, so that medium is just delightful. It really got me. And painting with the eyes closed and gestures and knowing when to stop. So it was fast. Then opening the eyes and see this surprise, this amazing, these forms that surprised me, the strength, the different lines. I was working with different materials like wood sticks, I will add everything else. So I would do very little lines. I was just following my rhythm or big brushes, all the Chinese ink brushes. Like, that was delightful. Then I started using acrylics. I kind of moved out of the oils. In that time, I was feeling, I don't know, the water base pulled me. So I started using oil pastels, mixing with acrylic, black acrylics. That was another thing, because I like a lot drawing. So these drawings were, the paintings had a lot of drawing. Then when I started moving into color, it was canvas and still big formats and acrylic. So I like the water-based materials. Sometimes I use, so then I started using mixed media as well, because I like texture. Sometimes I would use paper like collage and sand and mix it with the painting and trying to create like the three-dimensional, but always with the eyes closed. So it's more like the feeling and sensations that it gives into my hands and how my body moves. I usually paint or on the wall or on the floor to incorporate my body.
So you always have your eyes closed then, no matter what you do now?
And in the beginning, because that was a training, this has been like almost 30 years. So I like to close, because what happens with the eyes closed is moving out of the ego and the mind and the control, and is surrendering control, the same as the left hand. I like to start in that way, so I get attuned within. And when I open the eyes, I notice it's like a dance. Many times I open the eyes to choose the colors, and then it's when I'm painting, the breathing is a very important aspect. It helps to connect within. And then I start my gestures. And sometimes I open the eyes, but I'm not necessarily looking what my hands are doing. So when I allow that flow, sometimes my paintings can be done in 15 minutes, an amazing piece. And sometimes I can be working for days and days when I get caught, like when the eye gets caught or controlled. There is something about, the more I open the eyes, the harder it becomes the flow. And I notice that. So many times it's just a sense. I know when I'm controlling and when I'm not. And when I feel I'm controlling a lot, I close my eyes again. And then I involve my two hands. I paint a lot with the two hands. But the left hand, what it does in studying about it and in mindfulness, they talk about it. It helps you connect to the right side of the brain. And the right side of the brain is creativity. So it's an interesting journey around that, and then how the brain balances, because I know and I'm aware a lot of things happen chemically inside the body and inside my body when painting. And I've been seeing this happening also in my workshops, because what happened in the workshops is I merge both spiritual psychology and this way of painting with automatic painting. So it's accessing information almost at the level of the cell. I feel it with this technique and working intentions.
And you mentioned that you can complete a piece in some 15 minutes.
Sometimes.
Yeah.
Now, but so sometimes, not always.
Right. So I'm wondering how long you can maintain those sessions when you go into your studio to paint with your eyes closed, because it's a very meditative state that you're in, isn't it? So
yes.
Typically, how long would your sessions be, Claudia?
So I can paint for hours, and that's where it's interesting. But it depends on the moment and on the day. Sometimes there's a lot of noise and distraction, but when I feel I become one with my painting. And when I'm in that state, it's like I'm so present. But it's so present in what I'm doing that the noise, nothing distracts, which is a meditation. And I can last long periods, but I think that has been a training of years of doing this and painting in this way. So that's why in the beginning was very fast. The gestures were very fast, so I was not controlling. So I would paint many, many, many pieces in a session, many, a lot. Nowadays, because of all the practice, I have layers in with acrylics. So those layers I paint over and over. And sometimes I have three or four pieces at the same time. And when I feel I did gestures and I don't want to overwork something, I move to another one and I start from the beginning. So that's how I work. Sometimes I really like to work many pieces at the same time. And when, and that's why when they are bigger, the challenge is bigger. Even though painting small is more challenging for me. It's harder because I'm so used to the big and I like to do that. So sometimes I move into very small pieces. And it's very helpful because it moves me out again of my comfort zone. And I experiment there and I really like what happens. And then I project that into the big pieces. But it's like sometimes those 15 minutes of a piece, it took me all these 30 years to paint that. That's how I see it.
You've said that your artwork is a constant search for self-understanding. So I would imagine there's a different degree of satisfaction with each piece and what you get out of each piece in a very spiritual way.
Yes. And you can see my series. I see it. It depends on where I am and what I'm working on. And I'm very aware that if I do it even intentionally or non-intentionally, is where I am in my life and inside of me that is it comes present. So it depends, and I can see that. And sometimes even the colors I choose, everything I do in these conversations with my body became very clear that I allow my body to dictate the colors. So I ask, and sometimes, and that's part of my workshops, is how, depending on the intention, where are you in your body? And where, when I paint, is where I am present. And that guides the colors. And it's interesting because some people and many of these artists that I'm very inspired about talk about how they, like Joan Mitchell, talk about how she was bringing her landscapes into the painting, but not mirroring them, but painting more what they left inside of her. And I feel in that way, with a difference that I don't intend to paint figures. I don't think about the horses or the landscapes. I just connect with it, and whatever is present inside of me comes out. And then I see, after I paint, is where I see a landscape. This talks to me about a landscape, or I see horses, or just the forms when they are very free or they are tangled. So I start to see how, when there are sometimes I flow that I feel so balanced, sometimes I'm more tangled, and that shows in my work. And that's where I start to learn about myself, and I let all that out. And that's the interesting part about it. So that's why they evolve, the colors change according to my present moment.
I was going to ask that, if there is a preferred time of day that is more productive for you and more spiritual, and where you can really adjust to the moment once you step inside the studio.
You know, it's interesting. I really like to paint at night, but I'm very good. I like both. Because my life, what happened with my studio and my art as well, is it allowed me to have my family life. I'm very free in my time. When my kids were little, it was very nice. I would be present with them, drop them off in their school, and then go and have that space and that quiet. So Mondays for me were the best days, because it was, oh my God, I'm back in my studio. Have this time. But then when they were more like babies and I had my studio in my garage, nights were the best time because everything was quiet. Everything was complete and accomplished. And I was able to really go deep, like that quiet, no noise. Even the world is sleeping. So it's a nice time. And sometimes I do that when I have presentations, commissions, big works that I work a day, then I go back at night when everything is complete in the house. And few artists work at night as well. Oh, it's a very productive time. I like both. I like the day as well. It's fun and happy, and the night is very deep as well. And as an architect, all my career I was working very late and not sleeping and all those. So I got that also from that time. So I'm good at working at night as well.
And you like to paint in silence too, you've said.
Yes.
That's preferred, and you might have listened to meditations or get you into that state.
Yes.
And I love that your studio is in an airport hangar, and that itself seems to be the ideal environment, because artists always need more space, but the space must give you the freedom too.
Oh, yes. And my studio is huge. It's like the biggest. So I have a lot of space. I can host my workshops there, and I paint. I have an area to hang my work as well. Yeah, it's expansive. And the airport has a beautiful symbol for me, because my family, my grandparents, they own a bookstore in Bogota in the airport for my entire life, way beyond I was born. And I used to go there during summer or winter vacation to work. Since very young, since I was 7, I really loved being around books. That was another aspect that influenced. And I would see all these spiritual books that were going out. I would read about them. I would, and the fact of the airplanes, the sound of people traveling, the flight, the sound. And going back and having, interesting enough, my studio is in the airport. So I hear the airplanes all the time. It immediately, you know, connects me to these amazing times of my childhood working there. So it's very, I feel home. It's interesting.
Because what you do is so visceral, it's so physical in the grandest sense of the word. I'm wondering how your emotions must be, Claudia, at the end of each session. Do you ever find that you're in tears? It becomes such a connection, such a strong spiritual connection, and what it reveals.
Yes. So what happens when I work, there is something I feel like is like an integration of all aspects of myself when I work. And many times emotions show up, and I work that in my workshops a lot, like letting them out, and it's painting with them. I feel sometimes there's a release of emotion, and it's liberating, and the crying, and sometimes getting into memories. And what helps me now is with all the skills and tools I learned in the master's on spiritual psychology, help me and support to use this. I use all this as a growth and healing and understanding. And that's why it's all this self-discovery, because it's always I'm learning more and more about me through my art. And I get in touch with memory. Sometimes I'm not even aware of what memory is, just something comes out. Sometimes there's so much deep loving or deep feelings that I don't know what I cannot describe in words. It's touching that gap of between feelings and emotions that is not articulated, but it shows up in the forms, in the abstract. And tears come, and I just allow all that to happen. With my teacher in Colombia, sometimes we used to work even with sounds, like inner sounds, you know, sometimes it's a scream, and following the gesture with the noise and the sound. And sometimes what I do, I learned this technique in the master's on spiritual psychology named freeform writing. And I like to start sometimes when I feel I'm charged, and I do that a lot in the workshops, is writing for 5 minutes or even 20 minutes. The freeform writing is writing whatever is present without rereading. It's like a throw up of emotions, whatever. You don't reread, it's just a release, and then burning it. In my studio, I shred it and take it out. It's like a release of energy, negativity. It's like an outlet. But sometimes there is a lot present, a lot of information, so I can release whatever, even a hard warning. And then a lot of things can be released in that. It's like an emptying a vase that is full of things. So then I feel more empty, and I can work and get more balance and start just painting.
So where do you feel the most satisfaction in your art then? Is that's, I know it's a very big question, but can you narrow it down to things that you take away from each piece that are most satisfactory? Are there elements of it?
Well, the most satisfactory is doing it. In the times I stopped painting, it became like a need. When I don't paint, I notice how it affects me. It's when people are very into exercise and they feel in their bodies when they stop. Is this the most satisfactory part? Is doing it. Then when a piece, there are sometimes that I see pieces that for a reason just fulfill me, like, whoa, this. And I tend to have a lot of those in my house. Like they connect me to something, like they surprise me. And then all the other aspect is when I get tangled and even I struggle with the painting because it's a reflection back to life. It's a mirror. And how I struggle and then no, and then it gets terrible. I don't want to see it. Then, and finally it comes together. That moment is delightful. Is that satisfaction? It's the same as when I used to do furniture design and when I show and people would see them and get super, when they were getting them or buying them, and the happiness that fulfills me. In the same way, when I show the work and people get in touch with it and connect to it, that's another moment of a lot of satisfaction. It's and growth and getting to know my people, talk about my work, and even just people that not necessarily art critiques or just the people when they see and what they see and how they share and how they get in touch to parts of themselves, all that aspect as well is fulfilling.
So what do you like to hear about your art when you listen to others privately?
Well, yes, I like to hear the stories of what they see or when they get impacted. Oh, and they just stare at the painting and then they share what they like about it, either the colors, like when they get drawn by the art, inspired by it. And the stories they see. Many times I had the experience of people coming in and they would say, oh, I see a wedding here. I see judgment. And I was, where do you see that? I was not even seeing that. So how it becomes a story. And then that opened up my own story. I was, oh, now I see what you're seeing. That aspect as well is fascinating. I like to hear that. And I show my work to my kids a lot. And they have very different opinions. I really like how they talk about it, as well as my husband. And he sees things and he gets also drawn. Sometimes he's, oh my God, I want that piece. I need it for my office. So it's interesting how our collective, I can come from my own world, but this collective consciousness that we all share, that fulfills me, just seeing how the art impacts. And to me, yes, when I finish, it's different, each piece in the series, and I have different special connections to each one. And many times I don't even remember how they came together. Sometimes I do. So they have all, they become like my babies.
Speaking of your babies, I know Emma and Thomas have very different interests, but did you inspire them to do art?
Yeah. Well, I always took them. I try to take them to my studio a lot, and there is a balance on it. They like to go and then they don't. I see how the, and more when they became teenagers, they stopped going as much as little kids. But I see how it influenced my daughter that is studying now architecture. And I did architecture. So how I, it was not my, I didn't tell her, it was her own. It surprised me. So I see how the under influence goes, and we'll see with my son. He's more into sports. Even though he was very, in elementary school, he was a lot into arts and creativity and in writing, poetry. So we'll see. I talk to them a lot about them. Sometimes And what I like, and they are very involved because I tell them they come to my open studios and they talk to me about what they like. I send a lot. Even my son, sometimes I ask him, do you like this piece? And he's send it to Emma. We trust a lot on her approach and her, yes, her perceptions. And yes.
Now, you must have painted hundreds of pieces over the years, Claudia. So how do you measure success? What does it mean to you?
Oh, that's such a great question. And I work that a lot. I measure success by doing it. When I feel successful, when I'm creating a lot. And I feel accomplished, like complete. Sometimes I struggle with the world, like in art is hard, like, right? Like the success tends to be measured by selling, but making money. So I even did a workshop about color, money through color, something like that, to make peace with that. And for me, success is beyond that. Of course, when I sell a painting and people get connected and they commission, it feels great, but that's not, and that was part of my first 8 years of work with my teacher in Colombia. It was to let go that part of painting for others, of selling or making them like it, because then that will become another work, which would have another intention. So for me, I create just for the creating it. And even sometimes when I get commissions, I like to paint more than one piece so people can choose, because for me what is important is when you get a piece is because it really, you love it, like it gets you. So for me, success is that, when I paint and someone gets in touch as well, but not necessarily. And even when people don't like it, I learned that a lot in those 8 years. It was not about, maybe some people have the opposite, and that's success, because it's my language, and working that through the years, because it sounds easy, but not necessarily was. One thing is I really love to, you know, be inside my studio, nobody sees anything, and I work. And in the beginning, it was very hard for me to show my work, because it's vulnerable. And the growth that I had through the years with that, like I can show it now, and I don't have any, sometimes people, when I paint for them, like they commission, and I always say, if you don't like it, it's fine. Don't feel, I'm not offended by it, because it's not, because it's my own process. I'm fine with that. That's the success for me. Having that line that is beyond, like whatever other, and it becomes a very personal, whatever others think is not necessarily, it doesn't need to affect me, or it doesn't have nothing to do with me. And creating that separation also is a success. And the major success is just creating the job, the painting.
So my question then follows in terms of the non-commission work. If you finish a piece, is there ever a time that, that you are so connected, you feel so spiritually attached to a piece that you don't want to sell it?
Oh my God, that happened a lot. And in the beginning, and when I was in my master's and I did my conversations with my body, there were two pieces that I loved, even though the other ones I didn't. And someone asked me, I want to buy it. And I said, no. And then my husband, my friends were supporting me, like letting go is part of this. And then I sold it. And that was very important. And I have some pieces that I really have in my house that are not, they have a specific meaning. Even I have a very small one that I painted in 1999 with my teacher. And she told me, it was so special. She said, never sell it. Always keep it, because it has an essence of my work. And that one is like sacred. I keep it forever. But now I'm more free, and I sell. I tend to sell everything people want. But it's been a process, and sometimes it's very hard. And the other aspect is many people that I know buy my pieces, so I know where they are, and that's super special for me, knowing where they are.
Yes, I can imagine knowing they're hanging in someone's house.
Yeah, that I, yes.
And what about the galleries that you're associated with, Claudia?
So I was before associated with a guy, but in that time, in that case, I just let go and I'm fine. And I learned that was another process. And lately I have been working in, since COVID. Again, we came back to my studio and I do a lot of openings and shows in my own studio. And I like to work in that way. But also I had, and I have had galleries that have my work and they take care of it. But I like to be as in touch as possible.
What is the address of your studio if anyone would like to visit?
Yes, it's 3026 Airport Avenue, Santa Monica, California, 90405, the zip code. And my studio is Studio 27.
Do you think about your reputation and your legacy? Does that hold any water for you at this point in your career and your influences? Since you give workshops too, you're a coach.
Yes. Well, the legacy, well, I think about it. Sometimes I even think, I see my paintings, they will survive me. What is going to happen with them after? I don't know. And I think about, and it's seeing how I go to museums and get so in touch with this, with the art and the artists and their lives. And yeah, I wonder in that way, what is going to happen. And of course I have goals and dreams, and I study a lot of that in the Masters on Spiritual Psychology, how those goals and intentions can be 50% real. I'm a very, I dream a lot. Like I have a lot of big dreams and I like that. And I teach that to my kids, dream big. It doesn't matter how they at the end happened. And seeing in retrospective, I see how much had happened that I dreamed as a child, but I never imagined it was going to happen in this exact form. So I work that a lot. But I, of course, I would like my work to continue to expand worldwide and be seen in more places. And yeah, I'm looking forward to that and see how that happens. I like social media helps that a lot and is happening a lot. And I enjoy a lot that when people get in touch to me from everywhere and see the work and get inspired just by social media. That's another, yeah, way of impacting. Yeah.
It certainly does, yes. What does 2023 look like for you then, Claudia? Is it a busy year?
It's been already very busy. Usually I'm busy with workshops in the beginning of the year. And it's been busy in painting. I've been painting a lot lately and a lot of commissions, big pieces, and I'm painting bigger and bigger. And yeah, that's satisfying. That's success for me, like the painting bigger and bigger. So it's been busy. We're going to have in the art studios an open studio soon in May 13th. Where all the artists of the, and including myself, we are opening our studios and showing our latest work, and it's open to the public. And I'm planning to do some workshops in Colombia, and I have some goals in showing my work there as well, because I have many friends and people that want to see it there. I haven't done it in years since we moved here basically, and so that's a plan for this year. We'll see.
Yeah, it sounds like you have plenty happening in your art world, Claudia. So I'm very glad that you found a few moments to share your story. But before you go, I'd like you to tell everybody how they can find you online and on social media so they can connect with you.
Oh, thank you. So you can find me in my website, claudiaconcha.com. That's my maiden name, claudiaconcha.com. And my Instagram is claudiaconchaart. So you can follow me and see my work and my latest. I post, sometimes I post more, but you can see there my latest work as well. And the workshops as well in my website. And there you will find the information, how to contact me, my email, in case you want to schedule workshops. I do one-on-ones or groups, so you can get in touch with me as well.
Wonderful. Well, thank you so much for spending time with me, Claudia, and sharing your story. I really have enjoyed it.
Thank you, Chris. Thank you for giving me this opportunity.
And don't forget, you can join in the conversation too on our social media. On Instagram, we're at The Art Podcast. That's The Art with two A's. Do tell me who you would like to hear from on the show. I'll be back next week when my guest will be Sarah Sedwick.